Hello, everybody. My name is Alexey Marushak, and today, me as a member of Bayon's team, I was lucky to be invited to Herpeton 2019 in San Diego, California, one of the biggest international herpetoculture conferences. And guess who is standing near me? Yes, this is Philippe Devojoli, the godfather of herpetoculture all over the world. I think everybody knows him. So, Philippe.
Yes.
Will you tell us when and how your fascination with reptiles and herpetoculture start? What is the brief biography of the world's best known master of herpetoculture?
I think I talked about it earlier. Kitty was walking into that store in Paris where this former keeper of the Jardin des Plantes had this vivarium with a variety of species in it. And again, I can remember a leopard gecko and a day gecko. And I thought, that's what reptiles do. They're so, the intricacy of scalation and color, the way they moved, I was immediately fascinated. And I consider that, there's something I call a gateway event, which is like your life before and your life after. This was a gateway event that it opened my way, opened a way to the world. It kind of served an existential role as far as purpose and meaning. It's like, wow, this is a direction. This is a reason worth living for. And it was that everybody that I know who's into amphibians and reptiles, and you probably have too, we all have that one moment that I call this gateway event before and after.
Yeah.
Falling in love,
yeah.
The same thing.
Yeah. Everybody has that such moment.
Exactly.
Of course. So the Paris is the city where herpetoculture started.
Well, no. For
cool.
me.
Cool.
Okay.
Okay. So the next question is, you're author and co-author of more than 50 books on herpetoculture that are really must-read among all our like-minded people. How many books are you currently working on, and on which topics?
Unfortunately, I'm really not working on anything right now because the way the book market is, the last even 2-3 books I've done, for the months of work I put into it, and again, my wife will get on my case for it for the amount of time. I've made so little money that I don't know how worthwhile really a lot of the book market is nowadays, unfortunately.
Cool. Okay.
So, maybe not the answer you expected.
I hope that you're lying.
Okay.
Okay. Okay. And I think that it would be interesting for our subscribers. Who inspired you at the beginning of your journey, and what are your inspirations now? It might be a person or an event, like in Paris or something like that.
Talk about you again. I think in Paris was one thing,
yeah.
And then later, and I've talked about this, and I've kept reptiles and amphibians over time. It was a symposium in San Diego, and I think I talked. I'd come there from Massachusetts, and I came here. And I've always liked amphibians and reptiles. And I was in Old Town, San Diego, and it was it was the beginning, and the symposium was on this kind of stuff, the beginning of the hobby. I was outside drinking Corona beers, mariachi players behind me, Mexican mariachi players. It was outside a stand, and if you go to Old Town, there's these beautiful old eucalyptus trees, and the same thing, it was that moment that goes, I'm moving to California. And within 3 months, I moved to California. Then I met Bob Mayhew. And Bob Mayhew is certainly a very important figure in U.S. herpetoculture. And he helped me out in a lot of ways. And we worked together for a while. And it wasn't too long. We were, same thing, drinking some beers at home. And he goes, why don't we start, how about the Vivarium magazine? And it kind of started. From there was the Vivarium magazine, and maybe a bit like putting this conference. I started talking to people, and before you know it, we had the foundations of the American Federation of Herpetoculturists and the Vivarium magazine, and it took off from there.
Cool. You know?
And later, by the way, there was a point where all these, it started with horned frogs, in fact, people were killing them, not knowing how to do them. And I had the idea of my little black and white book series, which I did because I didn't want the animals to die. But then it became commercially successful, mm-hmm. and I built my publishing company.
Cool. You just told us about the Vivarium magazine. Frankly saying, when I need some exact or some really valuable information, the first source that I use is your old numbers of Vivarium magazine.
Oh yeah.
So okay. Can you please tell us a few words about the history of this magazine and how can such magazine can possibly function online nowadays?
You know, the way the magazine at the time, again, it was all new, and I felt that the members of the private sector were not recognized for all the great work they were doing. And there was zoo magazines for zoos, but I felt, you know, the private sector was not represented. That's how I started the Vivarium magazine. Same thing, the American Federation of Herpetoculturists represented, you know, the private sector. And it went for 13 years, but what happened, and it also happened with my books, is other magazines came out and big corporations did everything they could to put us out of business. Mm-hmm. We were the most widely distributed magazine on herpetoculture. They put out other ones, but they had agreements with large chain stores.
Yeah, even we in Ukraine know the Vivarium magazine.
But they got us out because like TFH tried to put me out of business forever, and they had these agreements with stores, they had the distribution to stores. Then they got me out of that. Mm-hmm. It was major. And after that, it was the beginning. We lost so much distribution, we couldn't do it because they did, you know, their magazines are no longer around, but they did everything they could. Same thing with my book business. They did but we survived what they did with the book business. But that's why that faded away.
You know, unfortunately. Anyway, so here we just heard some propositions about restart something like Vivarium magazine, and I hope it will be reality. I hope so. I'm only 25. I hope that my children will read something like that.
Maybe, and again, we have to talk, you know, to people, but maybe, again, instead, less, we need to present a bigger picture, a little bit like Petronekas talked about, what we talked about. Show bigger goals, bigger ideas, you know, show that we play a role in conservation, address education, responsible herpetoculture, like Dimitri presented. Yeah. And so use, instead of just, well, how do I keep and breed this, have a good deal addressing, in a way, what we represent, or beliefs, or image, mm-hmm. because we really need, from a public relations point of view, you know, we need to show that we're not just pet keepers, we're not just people into keeping amphibians and reptiles to make money. We really do care about bigger issues like conservation.
This is a really cool goal.
Right.
Okay, so how do you feel about breeding of special morphs? So there are two points of view that from one side, this is like the mindless playing with genetics, and we are like breeding bastards. Yeah, and they have a lot of, so such animals have a lot of illnesses, a lot of genetic related diseases. Or this is also a valuable part of herpetoculture and it worth being.
I think there are problems that are going to happen from line breeding, I think leading to inbreeding depression, because again you just narrowed the gene pool and just breeding for a trait. You're not diversifying it, so it's going to lead to problems. However, you have to recognize in a way the aesthetic and artistic value that some morphs have from people. And some of these morphs are going to get people interested in reptiles and amphibians that they never imagined they would. All the varieties of ball pythons, I mean, it's not of interest to me, but you know, some are dramatically beautiful. People who have never thought about owning a snake before will think about owning a snake in a way, or green iguanas, yeah, now bright yellow, red. It does same thing, it does open that door, it opens that gate that makes them consider the bigger picture. So it's not ideal, but it is It is part of the hobby.
But it has positive.
You can't escape
positive
it. And as far commercially, it's part of it, but you can't escape that. It's not all bad. I mean, it has a positive role in terms of, you know, recruiting more people, getting more people interested in the hobby.
Yeah. Okay. And which threats do you think will herpeticulture face in the 21st century? What awaits it tomorrow? And how can we, like, protect ourselves from these threats?
I think, you know, I see the biggest threat is the reduced availability of the diversity of animals. Mm-hmm. As you have more legislation, more restrictions coming. Climate change by itself is causing, you know, decline of animals. There's massive environmental destruction. Yeah. The tendency for a lot of countries is, you know, when animals start declining, and it may have to do with, you know, habitat destruction, but they're going to use the trade often as a scapegoat. Mm-hmm. And it doesn't address the real problem, and we see that quite a bit. Now, there are issues where, again, there are issues, say, the, you know, smuggling of radiators out of Madagascar is absolutely wrong,
yeah.
And we need to oppose that. But just think, the way the world is now, more and more animals are going to be listed, protected, supposedly, but protection is not going to prevent a lot of the horrible things that are coming.
Yeah.
That's a fact.
Yeah.
So this affects us directly because, again, we so often something may have to do with habitat destruction, they're going to blame the exotic pet trade.
Yeah.
You know? So we're easy scapegoats for that, and we need, it's probably, I think, the biggest threat we face is, you know, restriction, lack of availability, more and more.
Okay, so it's always better to do something than not to do anything.
Correct.
Yeah, of course. Okay, so how do you feel about creating of some international herpetoculturist organization that can protect interests of amphibian and reptiles breeders, keepers, and big centers like Bayonne or other centers? So will it somehow help, to your opinion?
I think, a big problem, and I think I brought this, has to do with the public relations. How do the public see us? A lot of the media, you know, will have negative articles about us. You have environmental groups, again, we are often the scapegoats, and there's negative articles. We need to work on positive image.
Mm-hmm.
We need to work on presenting, you know, some of our broader ideas, the fact that we can contribute to conservation, you know, in different ways. And we have to be clear to oppose, you know, the misrepresentation as to what the cause is for animal decline. So I think, I'm not sure what's going to come out of Herpeton here. I'm hoping something. I think whatever broad positions we have here can be expanded to something global.
Cool.
So we need that, you know, it's like if we have a template,
mm-hmm,
for, you know, positions and all that are well thought out and rational, those templates, you know, can serve on an international level for, as Dimitri, again, and Bayon emphasizes,
thanks,
responsible herpeticulture.
Okay, so responsible herpeticulture is the...
It's a key
possible solution,
idea.
Yeah.
Key idea.
Main idea. Yeah, I think that's really important. And in some areas, even ordinary people, so people that are not related to herpeticulture in any case, they should understand that herpeticulture is not just the pet trade. Like, we get the animal, then sell it somewhere, and we are fine. No. We take responsibility, and that is one of the main goals. In the age of internet, which provides huge leaps to any industry, how it affects herpeticulture, the internet?
Well, I think, like I presented, you have a lot of ideas of the internet, but, you know, there, in some ways, there's so much information and so many ideas that it almost creates a kind of noise.
Mm-hmm.
So if you don't have a clear composition, clear music, clear set of ideas, mm-hmm, coming out of it, there's a lack of synthesis.
Mm-hmm.
And I do think that, you know, in politics, for example, you look at American politics, you know, Trump tweets all the time, but you know, he still has the rallies. Mm-hmm. He still goes out and interacts with people and shows his face in public. Mm-hmm. So I think that we have to see the value of the internet as a tool, but then we also need to show our face in public.
Yeah.
We also have to, you know, deal with real things, real exposure.
Yeah.
So
that's what, you know, we are doing right now.
Exactly. And so we have to combine both these aspects, but we do at times have face to face. I mean, I think you could see from this meeting, right?
Yeah.
The value, we could never have done this by, you know, typing up on the internet
via
Facebook. Never would have happened.
Yeah.
For me, it's important to see what a person looks like, their facial expressions, what it reveals of their character. You know, a lot of times people go text and I go, I'll call them.
Yeah.
Because I can hear their...
the intonation.
I can hear the intonation, what it reveals about them. So, you know, at this point, no matter how good or bad the internet is, the internet, social media, or tools, we cannot avoid that. We can't go back. But we have to look at the value of both, you know, real face-to-face, just like shows are an opportunity for us to have signage, information, have a mess. That's face-to-face, not the internet. So that's my idea. We have to combine
that's
both.
I absolutely agree with you, Philip. Okay, how many countries have you been to? To which countries would you like to travel in future? By the way, before you answer, I take this opportunity to officially invite you to visit Bayon Terrarium Center in Ukraine. It's just to improve your future answer.
Do you know, I agree, and I will have try to work it somehow in the future, because I think that whenever I see photos and things of Bayon, I do think that whatever you've done over there is truly remarkable. I think this combination of breeding facility, you know, I guess a commercial facility and a private zoo is just a great, you know, very I mean, believe me, I'm very impressed with what Dimitri has done. And just to say, you know, I think that the talks from Bayon, Petronekis, the great little video from Evgeny, I think it inspired a lot of people. And again, it opens our eyes to what people do in other countries. And I thought they were a fabulous addition. And I can't thank all of you enough, right?
Thank you very much
for coming.
We appreciate it.
Thank you very much for all your contribution.
Okay.
And I think we could gain our efforts to build a responsible herpetoculture.
I do too.
Thank you.
Yeah,
so.
Thank you.
So, Smile.
Right.
Okay, so it was Philippe de Vajoli, and I hope that we will go and
Alexei
find
Marushchak.
It was Dmitry Tkachev. We also thank to our video operator Sergei Prokopyev. So stay with us, subscribe to our page, do responsible herpetoculture, and have fun, guys. Goodbye.
Okay, bye.